Okay. Well, I've been interested in frogs for a very long time, since I've been about 4 years old. And I've done a lot of frog work in Africa, but what really interested me about New Zealand frogs were the fact that they don't make any calls. So they're silent frogs, and the reason I came to New Zealand was to try and work out how they talk to each other, so how they communicate really important things. And that's what I started off doing, but soon, because of their conservation status, I turned my whole interest into looking at how we can conserve the frogs and keep them alive, rather than actually looking at how they communicate. But we're still working a little bit on how they communicate as well. So we've got four New Zealand species of native frog. We've got two on the North Island, and we've got two on islands in the Marlborough Sounds. New Zealand frogs are really special because they are the ancestral lineage of all modern day frogs. So when you look at a New Zealand frog, they only occur in New Zealand. They have a lot of really primitive characteristics that make them almost more similar to salamanders than they are to other frogs. So they have very peculiar things. They don't have an external ear or a middle ear. They have ribs in their belly. They've got extra number of vertebrae. A lot of very primitive characteristic. They've even got a tail wagging muscle, even though they don't have a tail. With frogs in New Zealand, you think, well, they're pretty safe because most of the time they occur in conservation areas. And so their habitats are safe. And we've been patting ourselves on the back, and we've been going to international conferences. There was a big World International Conference in Brazil in 2008. And we were congratulated of the conservation efforts that we do for our frogs, because we've got them all nicely locked up in reserves and they're all pretty well protected. But of course, if these reserves are taken off Schedule 4 and they start mining in these reserves, then that's going to be the last straw that will break the camel's back, and our frogs will just join another list of frogs that have become extinct. And it's going to be a tragedy for New Zealand, because we could have prevented it, and I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure that these frogs survive, so that my children and their children can actually see these really unique New Zealand frogs. The map that I've got there is it shows the historical distribution, so it's from the herpetological atlas that we're developing in conjunction with Doc, and it shows the historical distribution of Archie's frog on the left and Hochstetter's frog on the right. Remember, with the Archie's frog, that we've lost 88% of those dots, so a lot of those dots have almost disappeared. But the most worrying dots are these ones up here, and these red areas are the ones that the areas that the government is proposing to take off Schedule 4. So they're going to open up those red areas to mining. This area here is where we have some of the few remaining populations of Archie's frog and Hochstetter's frog. And this is actually the type locality of Archie's frog, which means that this is the area where Archie's frogs were first described from. And the type specimens in the museums that date over 100 years ago were caught in these areas here. If mining occurs in these areas, we're going to lose really significant populations of the frog, and the frogs are already threatened quite extensively anyway. So it really will be a tragedy if mining happens in these areas.